Now that I have come to the end of the road, and the sun has set for me, I want no rights in a gloom-filled room. Why cry for a soul set free? Miss me a little, but not for long, and not with your head bowed low. Remember the joys that we once shared. Miss me, but let me go. For this is a journey we all must take, and each must go alone. It is all a part of the Master's plan, a step on the road to home. So when you are lonely and sick at heart, go to the friends we know. Bury your sorrows in doing good deeds. Miss me, but let me go. Lionel DaCosta Alleyne of White Hill, St. Andrew, owner and operator of public service vehicle Minibus B72, devoted member of Hillaby Pentecostal House of Prayer, entered peacefully into rest on Tuesday, September 19th, 2023, at the age of 91. Lionel DaCosta Alleyne, affectionately known as Dads, son of the late Samuel and Ethel Murray, husband of Elsie Alleyne, father of Sandra and Judy Alleyne, Stephanie Alleyne Hurst, and Marcia Grant, grandfather of Jerry, Abigail, and Derek Alleyne, Julia and Tamisha King, Kyle and Jonathan Hurst, Kathy Ann Innes, Corey and Kevin Grant, great-grandfather of six, brother of the late Reuben Ward, Milton and Maud Alleyne, Hilda Licorice and Viola Springer, uncle of Pastor Ella Holder, Rupert Ward, Clyde and Victor Licorice, Barbara Jordan, Anna Shepherd, Juliet, Terry, and Armando Clark, Randolph and Ricardo Springer, Rovina and Lolita Ward, the late Reverend Undine Jilts, and many others. Great uncle of Cyriline Cummins, Eugene Grant, Tony Alleyne, Carmita Knight, Daniel Archer, Mary Applewaite, Nicole Licorice, Dwight Jordan, Danielle Shepherd, and many others. Father-in-law of Bernard Hurst, Wyclef Grant, and the late Wayne King. Brother-in-law of Margaret Alleyne. Grandfather-in-law of Brian Innes and Maria Alleyne. Relative of the Alleyne, Murray, Watson, White, and Ward families. Friend of Sylvester Niles, Margaret Vaughan, Orville Watson, Cicely Holder, Marilyn Boyce, Edgar Andrews, the Ford family, Anne Ford, Abina Clark, the White Hill community, the late Reverend Buddy Mose, and many others. A service of thanksgiving to celebrate the life of Lionel DaCosta Alleyne takes place at the Bethel New Covenant Pentecostal Assembly, Orange Hill, St. James, on Saturday, October 28th, 2023, at 10 a.m. The interment will follow in the St. James Cemetery. Funeral arrangements have been entrusted to the care of L.R. Harris Funeral Home, Husbands, St. Lucy. You may join the family for the live streaming of the service and interment at sharingmemoriesforever.live/LionelAlleyne.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. The streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you.
And dreams that are yet to come true. Yeah! All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
stand. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are they which die in the Lord from henceforth, yea, saith the scriptures, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, that where I am, there ye may be also. On behalf of the pastor and members of the Pentecostal House of Prayer, we want to offer our deepest sympathy to our Pastor Alleyne, our Brother Alleyne's children, grandchildren, family and friends. We pray God's blessings on you as we proceed. At this time, I'm going to invite our Pastor Bovell from the church at Hillaby to open for us in prayer.
Blessed good morning to everyone. Let's bow our heads. Our Father who art in heaven this morning, we are so thankful that we can be here. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity, for waking us up this morning, setting us on our way. We have the activity of every member of our body. And we thank you this morning, O God, for the life and witness of Elder Alleyne. As we come to celebrate his life this morning, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will comfort every heart, that you will bless us as we go through, that his life, God, would leave a message for someone. There is a song that says, what my record be when I leave this world. And Father God, I thank you this morning that when we look back on the times and the life, God, that we can say, thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord God, for journey and mercies for those that are coming and those that are here this morning. God, I pray that you will bless them in their going in and their coming out. I pray, oh God, that you will continue to cover us with your precious blood. And as we proceed this morning, God, that everything that is to be said and done may it be done to your honor and to your glory. For we've asked in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen.
At this time, I'm going to invite our Elder Wilmer Brooks to direct us. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A blessed good morning to one and all. Welcome to Bethel on this lovely day. We give thanks and praise to God in all things. Amen. We consider these to be showers of blessing. Hallelujah. We want to enter into a period of worship and some songs that would have been amongst the favorite of our dearly departed. I want us to sing as unto the honor and the glory of God this morning. Let's have church. Let's rejoice in the Lord, the one who gives, the one who takes away, and whose name is still blessed. Amen? Let's worship with our first song. I need no other argument. Hallelujah. Let's sing to the Lord.
Yeah.
rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. And now, thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are living on the hallelujah side. No longer separated from our God, our Creator. But now we have relationship with him. We're living in a new place. Hallelujah. Let's rejoice in the Lord. Oh, once a sinner far from Jesus, I was perishing with gold. But the blessed Savior heard me when I cried. And he threw his arms around me, and he led me to his fold. And I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Praises far and wide. For I have opened up toward heaven all the windows of my soul. And I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Help me ring my Savior's praises far and wide. For I have opened up toward heaven all the windows of my soul. And I'm living on the hallelujah side. Though the world may sweep around me with her dazzles and her threats, yet I envy not her vanities and pride. For my soul is out of whom the sunlight gleams, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Help me ring my Savior's praises far and wide. Open heaven, all the windows of my soul, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Not for all earth's gold and millions would I leave this blessed place, though the tempter to persuade me off has tried. Oh, for my safe in God's pavilion, happy in his love and grace, where I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Help me ring my Savior's praises far and wide. For I have opened up toward heaven all the windows of my soul, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Help me ring my Savior's praises far and wide. For I have opened up toward heaven all the windows of my soul, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Here the sun is always shining, here the sun is always bright. There's no place for gloomy Christians to abide. Oh, for my soul is filled with music and my heart with great delight, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Help me ring my Savior's praises far and wide. Oh, for I've opened up toward heaven the windows of my soul, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. And upon the streets of glory when I reach the other shore, and have safely crossed the Jordan's rolling tide, oh, you will find me shouting glory just outside my mansion door, where I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Help me ring my Savior's praises far and wide. For I have opened up toward heaven all the windows, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, glory be to Jesus, let the hallelujahs roll. Far and wide, for I've opened up toward heaven all the windows of my soul, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, for I'm looking up toward heaven all the windows. Oh, and I'm living on the hallelujah side. Oh, for I've opened up toward heaven the windows of my soul, and I'm living on the hallelujah side.
Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Now I'm living on the hallelujah side. Here the sun is always shining. Here the sky is always bright. It's no place for gloomy Christians to abide. Hallelujah. Knowing Jesus brings joy. It brings sunshine. I have a home prepared. Hallelujah. And anyone who gets to know him,
experiences that. And we are so glad that we have a witness that this is the case for our brother. And since this is the case, now we have a home prepared where the saints abide. Hallelujah. Over in the glory land. No. Over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. A home prepared where the saints abide, just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory. Mighty host, thou stand just over in the glory land. Oh, just over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angel band just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host, thou stand. Just over in the glory land. I am on my way to those mansions fair, just over in the glory land. There to sing God's praise and His glory share, just over in the glory land. Oh, just over, over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. Oh, what a joyful thought that my Lord I'll see, just over in the glory land. And with kindred saved there forever be, just over in the glory land. Oh, just over, over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land. Just over, over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. Oh, with the blood washed throne, I will shout and sing, just over in the glory land. Let hosannas to Christ the Lord and King, just over in the glory land. Just over, over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land. Join the happy angel band, just over, over in glory land. Just over, over, oh, there with the mighty host I'll stand. Just over in the, let's sing that one more time. The mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory, over in glory land. Just over.
Come on, rejoice if you have that hope, church. Rejoice if you have that hope. One day, we'll join the angel band just over in glory land. Another song said, what a day that will be. Hallelujah. When my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand, man, and leads me to the promised land, what a day. What a day. What a glorious day that will be. Hallelujah. We're glad today for everyone who has that hope. And we thank God that we have that opportunity because Jesus Christ has made the way. Amen? Amen. You may sit at this time, please. Mm-hmm. Bless the Lord. Before we have the first scripture reading by Miss Sandra Alleyne, let me just first of all welcome as well all of you to Bethel. It is lovely having you here. The circumstances might not be what we would like, but it's lovely having you here to support the family at this time of loss. We thank God for you. I want to welcome and single out all the ministers here. Now, this service is under the auspices of the Pentecostal House of Prayer. Is that what it's called? With its Bishop Strickland, who's here. But I want to also acknowledge the presence of my head, my pastor, and Pastor Odell, who's here. I want to also acknowledge Evangelist Francis here, another pastor with us. And then we had our Pastor Bovell as well, praying for us earlier in the service. I also acknowledge, however, that there are other pastors in the house. I see Pastor Marshall from the United Pentecostal Church, and I hope I didn't just say pastor, you're a bishop or something. Can't remember your actual title, but man of God, I appreciate you, and I welcome you. Could you correct me then rather than laugh at me in your seat? Amen. Also seated next to him, I see as well another pastor and a couple other pastors in amongst us. Please know that you're welcome here and honored at Bethel this morning. God bless you as you've come in, yes, to share Pastor Moses as well, a good friend of ours. Amen. And he and his wife, both pastors, is she here? Amen. No, she's not here. Both pastors in their own right, and we honor you here this morning. I also have been asked by Dr. Rommel Springer, the representative for the St. Andrew constituency, to ask you to have him excuse. He himself is dealing with a funeral within his family this morning. And apart from that, there is the conference a bit later in the day. So he has asked me to pass on his condolences to the family. And I do so at this time, most respectfully. So we're going to that first scripture reading from Psalm 46, verses 1 through 7, to be read by our sister Sandra. This will be followed by some tributes, beginning with one from our brother Sylvester Niles, who will come directly after the reading of that text. Can we have the mic at the podium? On?
I think it's on, though.
It's on, though.
Good morning, yeah, church. Yeah. Psalms 46, verse 1 to 7. Mm-hmm. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the strength whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen rage, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Here endeth the first reading. Glory be to God.
Amen. Thank you so much, sis. In lieu of our brother Sylvester Niles, whom I just announced coming, I want to invite Minister Morris Lee to come and offer at this time his tribute. Minister Lee, God bless.
Blessed morning to all. It's truly a privilege to be in the house of God in the presence of the Lord, wherein it has been written that in the presence of the Lord there is fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Bethel is the place of my birth. It's a place that will always carry special memories for me. That is where the old man died and the new man was raised to life eternal. Amen. Sister Kathy had contacted me and she had asked me if I'd be willing to give a tribute on behalf of Dad's, Father Alleyne, and I told her I'd be extremely happy to do so because Minister Alleyne and my family go all the way back several decades. Amen. So he's no stranger to me. I used the loophole in that invitation because she did not say if she wanted me to give a musical tribute or a written tribute, a spoken tribute. So I chose the opportunity to first give a tribute in sound. All set? The timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream, God will make all things new that day. Gone are the steps from where I stumbled and fell. Evil is past unto eternal hell. No more night and no more day. No more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See all around, now the nations bow down to sing. The only sound is of praises to Christ our King. And slowly the names from the book are read. But I know the King, there's no need to fear. There'll be no more night and no no more day, no more pain, never crying again, and praises to the great I am, for we will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See, over there is a mansion prepared for me, where we will live with our Savior eternally. There'll be no more night and no more day, no more pain, never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. Yes, we will live in the light of the risen Lamb. I observe the protocols in place by honoring God, the Father, God, the Son, God, the Holy Spirit. I honor Superintendent Odell in charge of this wonderful ministry, Minister Strickland, Bishop Strickland, Pastor Bovell, all of the ministers of God that are gathered here this morning, irrespective of whether you are a bishop, an elder, an evangelist, a deacon, I welcome you all. Greater still, I give a special welcome to the blood-washed, the spirit-filled, and the sanctified that has the expectation of that great hope that will never make ashamed. I therefore move to say a few words in tribute to the one we call Dads. I often call him Father Lionel Allen, and I use the words Father because when you have come to a place of spiritual maturity, having lived over 411, I believe it merits one being called Father without put in that name to replace the Heavenly Father. This week has been extremely significant for me because about 3 days ago, I had the honor of attending a homegoing service for a 28-year-old young lady by the name of Ashley Highland. I'm sure that dads would have known her grandmother, Pastor Highland. And the significance of this week is that Ashley would have been 28 years old, and dad's home we celebrate his passing today is 91. I mourn the passing of young people who did not get the opportunity to live as long as Elder Allen would have lived. But because Elder Allen has lived to that ripe old age of 91, I do not mourn his passing, I celebrate his life. Lionel would have lived to 91 years of age. And as a preacher, one has to be careful in giving tribute, because a tribute is not a sermon. A tribute is not a eulogy. So one has to walk a very thin line and deal with the challenge of what we call a tribute. But in doing so, I want to make at least 5 observations, and then I'll take my seat. The first observation I want to make is that he was born in 1932. That meant that he would have experienced World War II. And when World War II took place in 1939 to 1945, he would have been 7 years of age. And when World War II finished, he would have now stepped into his teenage days. So a tribute is defined as a statement, and it is intended to show gratitude, and I am here to show gratitude to Elder Alleyne and his family, his wonderful wife, all of his children. And I also salute him because of the several girl children that he would have fathered. And without going overly biological, it takes a strong man to produce a girl child. A tribute is also an appreciation. It's also a moment to take time to adore the life of the person whom we celebrate today. I therefore took the time to take the word Lionel to form the foundation for an acronym that I believe that best describes this wonderful man. The word L means, for me, laughter, because Lionel loved to laugh. And we know that laughter makes a merry heart. Laughter is like medicine for the soul. I would use the letter I to say that Lionel would have been innovative. And the reason why I say that he was innovative is that he would have come along at a time like myself, and what we have in common was our love for public transport. Lionel would have come along at a time, and those of us that are old enough to remember, that public transport would have been based on a square body put on a truck with tarpaulins to let down when the rain started to fall, how it's falling now. And Lionel would have been innovative enough to be one of the first business people to move towards taking what we call a freight truck and have a bus body built on it to his own design. And because of that, I would say that Lionel would have been a visionary for the public service vehicle industry. I use the letter O to say to you that Lionel was a very optimistic person. And the reason why I would say that he was optimistic, in the public service vehicle sector, there is no consistency where revenue is concerned. On a day like today, the operators will say that the rain fell into the conductor bag. I mean, I've checked conductor bags and never see water coming out of them. But Lionel would have been optimistic enough to know the fluctuations of business, just like the fluctuations of his spiritual walk, because sometimes, as we sing, sometimes we're up and sometimes we're down and sometimes we're almost down to the ground. Lionel would have been optimistic that if yesterday's takings were not up to the scratch of his projection, that there's always today and there's always next week. So he was an extremely optimistic person. I use the word N for never failing, because he was always ready to get up to the challenge. And if you fail at something today, I'm sure that he will be robust enough to go back to the place of failure and come forward and correct the mistakes, only to come out a lot better than when he went in. I use the word E in his name for the word, the letter E for the word economist, because having experienced World War II, I would have overheard him carry on many conversations with my father, who would have been born in 1899, and my mother, who would have been 100 years old today. They always shared a wonderful relationship. But because they experienced these world wars, I use that word economist because they will always look to improvise in terms of a breakdown for a vehicle. They will always tell us as young people, you don't throw away parts because you don't know if a world war going to break out again, and the country will not be able to import anything if the way to the country is blocked. So you have to improvise. You go to the machine shop, you take something and weld it together and perfect it and get the machine man to make it back like new all over again. So Lionel would have known how to economize. The final letter in his name is love. The letter L for love. The reason why I use that word love is that after he would have moved away from the public service vehicle days, Lionel, for those of us that knew him, would have seen him traversing the country with, I believe, a Noah van with two speakers on top, evangelizing. The love that I speak of is the love that he would have had not only for his family, but his love for humanity, because he believed that every person deserved to get saved. And the reason why I mourned 3 days ago is that the young lady that would have been buried 3 days ago, we were told that she has suffered for many years with an illness called lupus. And the reason why it would have been heavy on my heart, and I believe it would have been heavy on Lionel's heart, is that you cannot expect to preach and tell people that by the stripes of Christ that we are healed, and then subscribe to somebody stepping in a church because they have a medical background and tell you that there's no cure for lupus. The devil is a liar. Lionel will not subscribe to that kind of theory. So L also meant for me loyalty, in the sense that when Lionel was providing public service vehicle services with his bus, he had loyal customers. They knew that they could depend on Lionel to show up at 6 o'clock from Hillaby, at 7:30 from Hillaby, at 9 o'clock from Hillaby, and on evenings, irrespective of what they had to do or if there was a delay, they would wait in the bus stand because they had this assurance that this man, Lionel, was loyal enough that he would show up to make sure that the customers that he took to Bridgetown in the morning, that waited for him in the evening, that he would get them to their door at the end of the day. If something was wrong with the vehicle, he would use some other form of transportation and go through the district to let them know, well, 72 I'm working this morning, I have to do some mechanical work on it, so you could opt to get something else, but look for me tomorrow. This is the kind of love that he had, not only for God and for family, but love for the trade that he was blessed to carry on. The fourth point I want to make in tribute to Lionel, I looked up the name Lionel to find out what does this word Lionel mean. And it is really not just a one word definition, it is actually a sentence. Lionel means young lion developing into a mature lion. That's what Lionel means. And because that is Lionel means young cub or young lion developing to a mature lion, Lionel also means fierce in power. Lionel also means a fighter, one that is not willing to give up, but one that is willing to fight to the very end. It also means loyalty, as I would have explained earlier, with the relationship that he built with his customers, not for the bus fare to build up an account, but he took joy in providing service. And I remember Jesus would have said that the greatest amongst you is the servant. And in closing, my final point, I would want to say that when I would have heard of his passing, in my spirit, the word hearing would have jumped before me. And I just want to encourage his family to read as much from the Bible about the word hearing. Because in closing, I want to say to you that everything that God creates, he created it with ears. Peter cut off the ear of a soldier, and Jesus rushed to the soldier and put it back on because the soldier would have needed that ear to hear the voice and the message of salvation. Our scripture reminds us, he that have an ear, let him hear. And the Bible tells us that faith, the thing that we use to call ourselves Christians, it comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So the reason why I close by saying that in tribute to Lionel is because I acknowledge him as a man of faith. But even though the physical body is lying in the coffin to be buried today, I want to say to you that while Lionel's physical body is resting in the coffin and will rest in the grave, Lionel is still hearing. And the reason why I say that he's still hearing is because God created him with the ability to hear. And when God returns for his own, the ears that he created Lionel with, Lionel will be able to hear his name called from 6 feet down. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. May God bless you. Mother Alleyne, I love you. Children, I love you. Family, I love you. God bless you. God keep you. Elder Older, Trouble Francis, all of the ministers of God, I bless you in the name of Jesus. Thank you.
Amen, and we thank you. At this time, we have another tribute. This time, another musical tribute to be offered by our brother Grant.
Good morning to the church. It is indeed a privilege to be here this morning. You know, this occasion is sad, but the song I'm going to sing this morning is, tears can never stay in the streets of that city. We might cry, we might shed a tear here for that, but if we live our lives joyful, we are sure that we are going to meet him someday, and there will be no more tears, no more wreaths, there will be no more crying, but there will be all rejoicing.
If I could come
Beautiful reminder that tears will never, ever stain the streets of that city we sang about earlier, just over in the glory land. Amen? Hallelujah. No reefs of death outside my mansion door, man. It will be a time of rejoicing for those who have been redeemed. Amen? The blood-washed children of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I anticipate it, and I hope that we are all looking forward to that wonderful, wonderful experience. Thank you so much. At this time, I want us to stand, and we want to please have our second scripture reading from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 through 7, to be read by Miss Judy Alleyne. This reading will then be followed by the eulogy to be delivered by our sister, Kathy Ann Innes. Revelation 21, 1 through 7.
Good morning, everyone.
I'm Judy Alleyne, and I'll be reading the scripture verse from Revelation 21, 1 through 7. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there were no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down from God, prepared for a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of the heavens singing, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God shall be with him, and God shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying. Neither shall there any more pain, for the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "Behold, I made all things new." And he said unto him, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." And he said unto me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be with, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." Here end of the reading of the Holy Word.
Greetings to our Reverend Older, the host pastor of this church, our Reverend Strickland, Evangelist Trevor Francis, and all the ministerial pastors and you lovely people. I want to say good morning to all. This is a tribute for the life of Lionel, DaCosta, Alleyne. On behalf of the family of the late Lionel DaCosta Alleyne, I take this opportunity to express our gratitude to you for your support, thoughts, prayers, and encouraging words during this period of grief and bereavement. This has been a great loss to us. Your outpouring of sympathy and love has in some measure assisted us in coping with and soothing the pain which we have been experiencing. As we reflect on the life of Lionel DaCosta Alleyne, affectionately known as Daz. Not to mention your presence here this morning, it surely does mean a lot to us, and we are greatly appreciative. We have lost a son, a husband, father, grandfather, brother, uncle, father-in-law, brother-in-law, cousin, a dear friend, and a stalwart in the family. Lionel DaCosta Alleyne was born on the 1st of May 1932 to the late Samuel and Ethel Murray in the rural areas of White Hill, St. Andrew, where he spent his childhood and adult years. After receiving his education at the Hillaby Mixed Primary School, he began exploring work possibilities ranging from entrepreneur to bus operator with the Rockland Bus Company, mason, carpenter, joiner, electrician, and tailor, having built his own home, our home. Just to mention a few, Daz was a jack of all trades and a master of many. The song, These Hands, epitomizes the life of Daz. To give you a snippet of the lyrics of this song by Johnny Cash, these hands are the hands of a gentleman. These hands are calloused and old. These hands raised a family. These hands built a home. Now these hands raised to praise the Lord. Dad's ambitious pursuits were not restricted to being in Barbados alone, but these took him to seek employment and upward mobility in the U.S. Virgin Islands and in the United States of America to earn a living for his family. He was always looking for opportunities for betterment and explored traditional and non-traditional avenues for uplifting the social, economic, and financial well-being of his family. Some of us may recall Dad's transporting passengers to the city in his personal car, a Fiat. After the demand for his transportation services had outgrown the means available, he invested in a pickup truck, and those who know Law from St. Andrew, the late Law, that was the truck, and subsequently purchased a Leyland bus with registration B72 to commute passengers to and from St. Andrew. In the year 2023, there's much hype about innovative. Long before this fad, Daz was an innovator. He single-handedly constructed his own bus from a truck engine, which the young people of that era referred to it as a biscuit tin because of its features. This was followed purchased by the bus of the Hino, which he named the Peacemaker, because of the quiet experience when traveling on that bus. It was one of the main trusted and reliable means of transporting commuters from Bridgetown to St. Andrew and back. I would have just shared with you some aspect of Daz as a career person, but I am certain that I don't have to remind you that Daz was a family man who cared for and loved his family dearly. This commitment to family life commenced with his marriage to Grandma Elsie, whose love for her was unconditional some 67 years ago. This union produced 5 girls, Marcia, Sandra, Judy, Stephanie, and the late Jean. All of the girls at most times had to perform the roles and chores of the sons, which dads never had. For example, working as mechanics and construction workers amongst others. His daughters, Judy and Sandra, recall assisting their dad in playing the route from Bridgetown to St. Andrew. Prior to this, dads would have taught these two siblings to drive. Well, Marcia and Stephanie were as conductresses. I am not sure if these daughters were always accepting of the fact that there were no brothers around, but they performed their roles credibly nonetheless. As children growing up, instilling good discipline was paramount to dads for his children, and by extension, his grandchildren, as well as his extended family or anyone whom he came in contact. When his children became adults and relocated overseas, their relationship with dads was without boundaries. They were always in touch and kept connected via telephone, WhatsApp, Magic Jack, and most appreciably on occasions of frequent visits to Barbados. His love for them was absolute. This affection was extended to his grands and great-grands. It would be remiss of me not to mention Daz, the spiritual man. Above all the defining facets of Daz, I think that this characteristic aptly defines who he really was. This aspect took precedence in his existence, and nothing came in between. This commitment was supported by daily reading of the scripture and once weekly fasting. Don't get me wrong, I am by no stretch of the imagination saying that Daz was perfect, but his commitment, dedication, and devotion to God and his spiritual welfare was unwavering. From his life, he manifested his love for the Lord and the church, and his unparalleled belief in spiritual matters and things that pertaining to eternal life. Not only was Daz instrumental in the spiritual development and upbringing of his children and their children and the extended family, but also he led a life of example for those who he came in contact with him, whether it was friend or stranger. Persons in the community fondly referred to Daz as a preacher man or Brother Alleyne. These accolades were bestowed as a result of his passion and zeal in spreading and declaring the word of God on the street corners or wherever it was possible for him to do so. The lengths at which Daz went to share the gospel came at a minimal cost to him. Much to the disapproval of his children, Daz took his personal vehicle, A294, and he reconfigured it with speakers affixed to the top of the van, not for the purpose of being trendy, but to ensure that through the proclamation, those within proximity were able to receive the gospel across the landscape of Barbados unhindered. Some of the places where dads could be found spreading the word include Warren's, which is a massive supermarket, the Hillaby community, just to mention a few. Many of us are aware of Dad's pastoral care for the less fortunate. He adored visiting the shut-ins, the sick, and the elderly, and sharing a word from the scripture, offering comfort, hope, and cheer. Particularly the residents in the St. Thomas District Hospital looked forward to those visits and benefited from his exhortation and his benevolence. The White Hill community had no lack in the admonition which Daz gave as he sat inside of his home, and I quote, he said, "Repent and be saved. Give your heart to the Lord, for Jesus is coming back very soon." Undoubtedly, if Daz was here today, he would have welcomed the opportunity to be witnessing to us and proclaim the good news, but that is not to be. Daz loved his gospel music and would often be touched by the renditions of the melodies of prayers and the songs of joy and gladness. And when the music hit him, he gave a shake. So enamored by was he with gospel music. Daz made sure that he bought every record that carried the title Joseph Nels, who was his favorite artist. Daz outlived the nominal span of human life, which is 70 years. And he did so by some 21 years. Daz resided at White Hill St. Andrew for 91 years. As a long-serving resident, his heart and soul was for the people in the White Hill community. And he looked forward to the day when we, the residents of the community, would experience better living and community access within the district and its environs. He welcomed to see improvements in the road conditions that will minimize the perennial plight that have plagued the people of St. Andrew for generations. Whenever the opportunity arose, Daz and a few of his contemporaries advocated over the state of affairs in the rural district and were relentless campaigners for better access in the community. Unfortunately, Daz will never be able to see the work that is in progress, nor will he see the completion of it. But we comfort ourselves knowing that we who are left behind and the generations to come will be the beneficiaries of what Daz fought for. I am sure that Daz will be greatly missed by those who would have come into contact with him during their lifetime and his. He has fought a good fight. He kept the faith and finished his course on earth. We love you. Rest in peace, Daz. At this time, we, the family of Daz, express our gratitude to Marcia, one of his daughters, for the role she played in providing care and support to Daz and Mom. We are indebted to her for her commitment to the task, and we say thank you.
Thank you too, Kathy, for sharing with us on the life and times of Granddad. At this time, I invite Abigail Alleyne to come and to share her poem here at the podium. This poem will be followed by the offertory hymn, He Abides. We invite you to give as unto the honor and glory of God. Abigail.
I'll be reading a poem that I wrote. If roses grow in heaven, Lord, please pick a bunch for me. Place them in my grandpa's arms and tell him they're from me. Tell him that I love and miss him. And when he turns to smile, place a kiss upon his cheek and hold him for a while. Because remembering him is easy, we do it every day. But there's an ache in our heart that will never go away. We will always remember that special smile, that caring heart, and that warm embrace. His great faith is what kept him alive. He gave me the courage to survive. He was always someone that we admired. He kept us all inspired. To read the Proverbs, that's what he told us during every phone call. To read it and be wise. He always reminded us that God is on our side. He told us, I love you, and asked, do you know why? Because he couldn't help it, and he made sure we always felt it. Your Abby misses you, my favorite granddaddy tissues.
Bless God.
Bless God.
Let us stand, please,
for the offertory. Abides.
rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the hand of God in all my life I see. Oh, and the reason of my bliss, yes, the secret all is this, that the Comforter abides with me. Oh, he abides, he abides. Hallelujah, he abides with me. Oh, I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides with me. Once my heart was full of sin, once I had no peace within, till I heard how Jesus died upon the tree. Then I fell down at his feet, and there came a peace so sweet. Now the Comforter abides with me. Oh, he abides, he abides. Hallelujah, he abides with me. Oh, I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides. As a bird and just as free. Oh, for the Spirit has control. Jesus satisfies my soul. Since the Comforter abides with me. Oh, he abides, he abides. Oh, hallelujah, he abides with me. Oh, I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides with me. Thirsting for the things of the world, they've taken rings. Long ago I gave them up and instantly. All my night was turned to day. All my burdens rolled away. Now the Comforter abides with me. He abides, he abides. Hallelujah, he abides with me. Now I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides with me. He abides, he abides. Hallelujah, he abides with me. Oh, I'm rejoicing in my head. For the Comfort. Let's do verse 2. Oh, once my heart was full. Once I had no peace within, till I heard how Jesus died upon the tree. Be so sweet, now the Comforter abides with me. Oh, he abides, he abides. Hallelujah, he abides with me. Yes, I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides with me. Comforter abides with me. I'm rejoicing as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides with me.
Bless the Lord. May God bless you as you've given to his work. May you never lack in any regard. In Jesus' name, amen. You may sit at this time. Bless the Lord. There was a period during which our brother worshipped at the church right next to his residence in White Hill in St. Andrew, the Ebenezer New Covenant Pentecostal Church. He worshipped there. In fact, I should say he served there during that time, and all the family worship there before he became a member of the Pentecostal House of Prayer. The caretaker there at the time, the overseer, now our pastor, Serlene Cummins, who is not here today because she's off island, wishes to express her condolences and sends her regards to the family. I understand that Mother Alleyne was insistent that there be a tribute from the Ebenezer Church. It is our pleasure at this time. I worship there as well. It's our pleasure at this time to offer that tribute or pay that tribute in song. I invite my sisters to come and they'll be sharing with me in delivering this song. May it be a blessing to you. Our song will precede the sermon to be delivered by the minister evangelist Trevor Francis. And we do pray that God uses him to his glory and his honor when he comes to the podium.
Begun.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Minister Francis.
Grace be unto you. Peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm reading three portions of scripture. The first is taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. It reads, "To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die." The second reading is taken from the book of Psalm. Psalm 90, verse 12. Psalm 90, verse 12. "So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom." The third scripture is taken from the book of Luke in chapter 16. In Luke chapter 16, I'm reading verse 27 and 28. "Then he said, I pray thee, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment." The word of the Lord. Father, we thank you for this privilege. It is a privilege above the dead. We are asking one more time that the sharp cutting edge of your word would pare away all the excess baggage that gets us all confused, thinking we have time put down and we live here forever. May the sharp cutting edge of your word, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit who was sent into the world to convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, bring us face to face before mortality and the certainty that we shall stand before you to give an account of the things we have done in our bodies, whether they have been good or whether they have been evil. Hear us, we pray. Amen. It was not a surprise to me that part of the eulogy had to do with Brother Alleyne's ministry in visiting the shut-in and the sick. He faithfully visited my dad during the days of his illness, one of the few people that turned up on that hill. Today marks 14 days that Bishop Cuthbert Williams spoke at the funeral service for a young man in this church. That young man was 55 years, Brother Alleyne's junior. He spoke on the topic of choices. Come 7 p.m. tonight, the bodies of these two men will be lying in the same cemetery. The future of each of them is irreversibly fixed and eternally unchangeable. Both of them are going to be lying in the same cemetery tonight. Their futures irreversibly fixed and eternally unchangeable. Ladies and gentlemen, our choices are shaped by what we believe is real and true, right and wrong, good and beautiful. Our choices are shaped, in other words, by our worldview. And one's major task in life then is to discover what is true and live in step with that truth. I believe that the Bible, the scriptures, is the single unerring source of all truth. Absolutely so. And if anyone attends or actually officiates at more than 100 funerals daily, that person will have a worldview. The psalm that I read from Psalm 90 was written by Moses, the man of God, who in the wilderness was officiating at more than 120 funerals per day as the Israelites were dying as a result of their rebellion. Anyone who attends and officiates at that many funerals will have a worldview. A worldview is a way of seeing and comprehending all reality. The key word, I think, is choices. The way Moses saw and comprehended reality is stated in the Psalm 90 that I read. And briefly stated, this is what Moses was telling us in that psalm, which you would read a little later on after the funeral service. This is what I find Moses was saying to us in that psalm. First of all, he presented us with an authentic view of God. I use the Bajan, true view of God. And secondly, a realistic view of man, who God is and who man is. So in light of these two sobering truths that I have just presented, that's the reason why I read the appeal in Psalm 90, verse 12. Teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom. I wonder what he was getting at when he said the brevity of life. I did a calculation, and somebody has already mentioned that we are allotted 70 years, 3 score years and 10. And if by reason of strength, 4 score. And then it goes on to say they're full of trouble and so on. 70 years amongst the 25,000 days or thereabouts. If God permits you to go to 80, you will have about 29,000 days. Remember I said, one man whose funeral service was held in this church 14 days ago died at age 36. Brother Alleyne died at age 91. You do the math, because there are some smart mathematicians in this congregation this evening. You do the math. Life is short, ladies and gentlemen. That's what this psalm is saying. When viewed against the backdrop of eternity, however long we live here is short. 91, 101, as I went to a funeral the other day for a lady who lived to be 101. We had a man in Hillaby related to Mother Waterman, died at 101 too. It does not matter. When you put that age against the backdrop of eternity, it is short. That's the first thing we learn from Psalm 90. The second thing we learned from Psalm 90 is that death is certain. We don't have to look far. The evidence is right there in front of us. Death is certain. And I or you may be next in line, providing proof that one day each of us is destined to exit this life by death, unless the Lord raptures us. Scripture says it this way. And just as each person is destined to die once, and after that comes the judgment, so also Christ died once for all time as a sacrifice to to take away the sins of many people. Hebrews chapter 10, 27 and 28. Not only are we looking at the brevity of life and the certainty of death, we are forced to consider eternity. Eternity stares us all in the face. And we will spend it in one of two places: heaven or hell, where there is endless torment, unspeakable torment. Or in heaven, where there is endless joy, unspeakable and full of glory. Every time I read scripture, I cannot but take note that Jesus spoke more of hell than he spoke of heaven. I wonder why. This is how scripture puts it. The unrighteous shall go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Matthew 25, 46. I don't take the words of Jesus lightly at all. And this is my conclusion about Jesus, that he was the smartest, most intelligent, and most influential man who ever walked the face of the earth. When you find his equal, I want to meet him. You'll never find his equal.
Never. Never. Never.
What I've also found is that today a popular response to these three realities that I just put before you, the brevity of life, the certainty of death, and the unending span of eternity, most people respond to those three realities this way. They quietly delete God from their affairs. They don't make any fuss. They don't quarrel with the preacher. They just listen to the message, clench their fists inside, and storm out angry. That's one response. Or they may heap scorn upon what the Bible says about life and death. That doesn't change it. Jesus is the life. When the preacher says that, I hear people saying, that is pure rubbish. Jesus is the life. What life? But it does not change John 14, 6, when Jesus said, I am the life. You know what we would like to do? Change the definite article to an indefinite one, as I hear people doing. So I hear John 14, 6 repeated this way. Jesus said, I am a way. I am a truth. I am a life. And everybody is happy. But by the definite article, you're in trouble. There's only one way to God. And Jesus said, if you do not come to the Father by me, you're climbing up another way, and that makes you a thief and a robber. And a rebel, by the way, and you don't negotiate with rebels. I often hear people remark as well, who are you preachers kidding? Look, we do not need God to tell us how to live. We are managing on our own quite well, thank you. Now, people who talk like that have bought into the lie that death is the end of the road. He didn't buy into that lie. Not from what I heard him preach, driving about his van, Hilby. He did not buy into the lie that death is the end of the road. So if he bought into that lie, God lied to him big time. And to all the others that have fixed their hopes on eternal life. What I understand is that if day in and day out I stubbornly refuse to let God take over my life by refusing to pray this prayer, which is, Lord, teach me to realize the brevity of life. Let your will be done in my life. One day, God will say to me, Trevor, there was a time when I asked you to let my will be done in your life. And you stubbornly and stoutly refused up until the end. And you died without me. Now listen, your will be done. You, Trevor, your will be done. I hope you understand. Too many of us are waiting until the very last moment to do business with Jesus. Satan is in his glee when we keep putting off making the most important decision in life, which is receiving forgiveness for our sins through the blood Christ shed. Now, there is another way we can view these realities. That's one way people view the realities. But there's another way. It is suggested in two scriptures, and I read both of them. I make reference now to Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and Luke 16, 1924. Don't get nervous. I'm not going to preach that whole text from Luke 16. I deliberately read one verse. For everything, there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born, and a time to die. And here is my advice to you, as a preacher who myself tremble when God speaks to me about eternal realities with reference to heaven and hell, see to it that you are born twice and die once. Not born once and die twice. I hope you understand.
That's right. Amen.
So I'm leaving Ecclesiastes there. In addition to being born, that is, I call it entrance. I'm now using four E words to strengthen the points I've already made. In addition to being born, which I call entrance into this life, and dying, which I call exit from this life, the writer to Ecclesiastes left out two others. He mentioned the entrance, a time to be born, and the exit, a time to die. There are two others: existence and eternity. Entrance, books opened. You had nothing to do with that. Existence, lifestyle recorded. We just heard about his. Exit, books closed. God closes the books. And dare anybody open them back till we stand before the judgment. Eternity forever, dwelling place. And there are two and only two choices. Now, these four words are highlighted in Luke 16, 19 to 24, which I hope you will read. Entrance, two men entered this life, a man living it up, clothed in purple every day, lacking nothing. And then the other extreme, a beggar, searching the garbage for a meal, living from hand to mouth. His only friends, pariah dogs, who came and licked his sores. They tell me that there's medicinal value in the saliva of dogs. I don't know. And I don't want to know either. So you have these two men enter life. One born into the lap of luxury. Another one living in abject poverty. That's counted by the rich man. Now, neither Lazarus nor the rich man submitted applications to enter this world, meaning be born. We did not put in an application detailing the circumstances of our existence into this life either. We receive the gift of life as a loan from God. He opens and closes its pages. Brethren, ladies and gentlemen, use the loan wisely by preparing for eternity, because after we die, it will be too late to reroute the travel plans that were carried out during our lifetime. It means a lot to me when I read that the word Lazarus means God is my helper. Say what? That's what his name means. Yeah. God is my helper.
Yes.
Lazarus, poor, a beggar, full of sores, in the company of dogs. Yet he came into contact with the God of it somewhere along that line. This guy came into contact with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Otherwise, he could not have been going to the bosom of Abraham. There's no way. For all that he suffered in this life, somehow he carved out time to come into a relationship with the God of Abraham. That's why he's going there. Now, of course, I don't have to tell about the other guy. Too busy. during his lifetime to find any time for God. And so I love it when I read, he went, the angels escorted him. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord. The angels escorted him, carried him to a place of bliss. That song came to mind. We don't sing it again. In the arms of sweet deliverance, I'm going to lay my heavy burden down. Yeah, he went into the place of sweet deliverance. His final resting place for his body, the body, we know the final resting place for this one. It's going to be cemetery. But Lazarus? Yeah. Lazarus ain't had no funeral. His body remained where it had fallen. And when the, you don't call them garbage collectors anymore. It's called them now again. Men employed by the Ministry of Health and Sanitation. All right, dignify the man's job. Yeah. When those guys came around, they scooped up Lazarus' body full of sores and dumped it on the garbage heap outside the city called Gehenna. Yes. That mean nothing. Man is blissfully resting in the arms of Abraham. I go to the rich man because you don't want me to talk much more about Lazarus. I would like to linger there, though, because I don't want to talk with this rich guy at all. But the rich man was self-centered. He was a show-off, and he lacked nothing when it came to earthly delights. He had time for pleasure, he had time for business, but no time for the God of Abraham. No time for Moses and the prophets. The Bible is blunt as to how they exited this life. No big long talk about how they exited. Born, exited. Finally, the beggar died and was carried by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. He must have had quite a funeral. A lot of lies might have been told for him too. Rich man died. Poor man died. The funeral services would have been different, but the verdict on each of them would be, as we are going to hear this evening if you go to the cemetery, earth to earth. Dust to dust, ashes to ashes. What is the issue here? What is the issue here? Since the issue here in Luke 16 is not about riches and poverty, that's not the issue here. There was a belief among the Jews that when a rich person died, he automatically went to heaven. We know that's not true. And that when a poor person died, he automatically went to hell. We know that's not true either. The point here is that it is very important how we conduct our lives during the time that God has loaned us. And we can learn a lot from the rich man. So in closing, we can learn a lot from the rich man. You know why I am preaching like this? Because that's how I heard Brother Alleyne preaching from his van. He always was on this subject. You got to be prepared to meet Jesus, he said. That's why I'm preaching this way this evening. And even if he had not preached that way, I would still have preached that way this evening. We can learn a lot from the rich man's requests. I heard the rich man when he lifted up his eyes in torment. Please send Lazarus. The man has not changed. Listen, you read that story again. He has not changed. He still thinks that Lazarus is his errand boy. Send Lazarus. Send Lazarus. Well, bless my soul. St. Lazarus. And when Abraham told him there's a Gulf X, I like him a lot, though. I like him a lot. Don't tell me lifting up my eyes in heaven, I thinking about some disgusting brothers I got back in Hillaby who won't change their lifestyle. We're telling me what sending messages to them from the dead. But hear this man. Abraham, I have five brothers. I have five brothers back up there. Who are behaving like they're like running boat like wild coots. I wanted to send a message to them for me. Got to be kidding me. Let them come down there and taste we taste into it. You stupid or what? Five brothers in that text represent every unsaved person sitting in this audience who have not yet come into a relationship with the Lord. Those five brothers in our text, they are still living. They have an opportunity. Their eyes have not been closed yet. The curtain has not come down on their lives. They have an opportunity. And this rich man in heaven, in hell in torment, has a care for them. Oh, man. Let me hasten and close. You notice that he's praying to the wrong person at the wrong time in the wrong place. He's praying to Abraham. Abraham, can I help him? Abraham, don't tell him I can't help you. He's praying to the wrong person. Sometimes we come down today, we're praying to the wrong person too. In life, the rich man refused God's help. Listen to him in hell now. He is begging to become the one whom God helps. Too late. There is no opportunity for repentance after this life. Seek the Lord while there is opportunity. Call while mercy is great and grace is free. The only call to repentance offered is the witness of Scripture. It is enough. God does not save, give us a supernatural visitation. Now is the only acceptable time. So the funeral service is another opportunity to let Jesus come into your heart today. Tomorrow is not promised to any of us. Now, when we are facing death, the soul's readiness to meet God as Savior outweighs everything else that we think deserved top priority now. In the final analysis, no one will be able to blame God for not having enough time. Here, in essence, is the message the rich man's five brothers were to receive and act upon. I don't know about going back from the dead either. Because if you were going for early morning walk down one of these streets and a guy of your acquaintance died 10 years ago out of Orange Hill and you saw him hailing you to give you a message, you were favorite? I didn't think so. You can run, you run. If you can run before, you will run. So was this rich man getting up by sending somebody from the dead? As Jesus was given this parable, he was the only one going to the dead. And Jesus is now risen from the dead, sitting at the right hand of God the Father. He is the only one who went, tasted death for every man, went down the dark valley of the shadow of death, and has risen that each of us might have an opportunity. And we burning him off. We didn't even check him with him. We didn't check him with him. So this is the message that these five brothers, I believe, Abraham wanted them to hear. He wanted them to admit being lost in sin. Come to the point where they realize and confess to God that they had personally offended him by continuing to disregard his call. Scripture says, all have sinned. All fall short of God's glorious standard. I have to admit to being lost, and some of us won't do that. Who are you talking to? You calling me a sinner? You got to be kidding. I'm no sinner. But that's what the guy, the prodigal son, did. His first thing was, Father, I have sinned. That's the starting point. Then you got God's attention. Secondly, abandon your efforts to earn your own salvation. Everybody is doing that now. They tell me there are many roads to God. And if you insist that there's only one, you fall into the category of a bigot and you are narrow-minded. That's what the professors at the KFA campus tell me, that there are many roads to God. And if you insist that there's only one, you are a bigot and you're narrow-minded. I plead guilty. I ain't changing. Abandon yourself efforts to earn your own salvation. Man is separated from God by his sin. He needs a new nature and a new direction if he is to avoid spending eternity in hell. We cannot bring about this change on our own. So the scripture exhorts us this way. God, our Savior, revealed his kindness and love when he saved us, not because of the righteous things we had done, but God saved us according to his mercy. Titus chapter 3 and verse 5. Then stop ignoring the payment Jesus made for your sins. There's only one payment for sin, the blood of Jesus shed on the cross of Calvary. Scripture says, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. There's only one step left. Receive Jesus as Lord and Redeemer. We must put our faith in Jesus Christ and him alone for salvation. Acts 4:12 resonates with many of you. It reads, this salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name for men to call upon to save them under all heaven but the name of Jesus. I beseech you to let Jesus come into your heart and save your soul if you have not yet done that. Do it today. Because it is never too soon to do that, because no one knows when it will soon be too late. Here today, gone today. Let's pray. Oh, yeah, it's with me. I'm appealing to anybody here today who does not know Jesus as Savior. Not going to ask you to lift your hand or come forward for prayer. We know ourselves. Death always brings us face to face with our own mortality. You could be the next one providing proof for the brevity of life, the certainty of death. I won't know much about the eternal side. I'm going to ask the musicians just to play a little there in the background for me. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins. Then we'll be able to join in that nobler, sweeter song, singing his power to save. When this poor, lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave. It's time to make a decision. There in your seat if you're not saved yet. Sincere by faith I saw the stream, thy flowing womb supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. You ready or are you ready? There is a fountain open for sin and all uncleanness in the house of David. There is a fountain. One more time, sir. Sing the first verse with me, Elder Brooks. Prayer, or you can talk to God on your own, but talk to him. Almighty God, who created the universe by the power of your word and afterward made man, I acknowledge my need for your salvation. Father, I'm dead in trespasses and sin. And only you can save me from my sins. I humbly confess them. I humbly acknowledge that your Son, Jesus Christ, is Lord. That he died on the cross and shed his blood to pay for my sin. As you have told me to, I have come to the place to believe in my heart that you raised Jesus from the dead. I believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead. Asking you to cleanse me and make me your child. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
This service moderated. At this time, I invite the Reverend Brenda Harris to come at this time. She will offer prayer for the family. Following her, kindly receive the Bishop Strickland, who will offer the benediction before we sing the recessional hymn. And by God's grace, be able to leave this house to go to a place of rest for our brother's mortal remains. Reverend Lupinda.
Let us pray. Father God, we do give you thanks and we give you praise this very hour because you are a good God. We acknowledge that you are indeed worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun until the going down thereof. We declare that you are a great, mighty God, a shield, our shelter, and most of all, a strong, strong, strong tower. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to come to you, looking to you, knowing that you are a God that is able to do all things. You're mighty. We lift the family of Brother Alleyne to you. We thank and praise you for his life and service to them while he was alive. And we pray that they would feel your presence even now at this time of need. Father God, grant them your presence to comfort, your presence to guide, your presence, Lord God, to reassure and to sustain them even through this time. I pray, God, that those in this family who serve you, that they will be strong in you, Lord, and in the power of your might. May those who do not know you be drawn through these circumstances to you, the one Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We thank you for the life and witness of Brother Alleyne, and we pray, Lord God, that the seeds of your word that he has sown into this family, Lord God, would grow and would bear much fruit. May the precious memories of him encourage them to know and to serve his God. We thank you, Lord God, for taking this family into your care at this moment, soothing sorrow, healing wounds, and driving away fears. We thank you, Lord God, for doing what seems to be impossible in their lives, God, and being to each of them, Lord, all that they need so that they too will have a testimony of your life and your way of living in their lives. I know, God, I ask you to take us all into your care. We thank you, Lord God, because you have allowed us to do so many things, Lord God, in these moments. And we say with great faith this moment that you are our God, and to God be the glory. Great things you have done. Do for us again what you have done already. And we thank you and praise you for being to us all that we need. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Harris, the pastor at the French Village Pentecostal House of Prayer. Please stand. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. And Heavenly Father, as we would leave this place to go to the cemetery, we ask your divine guidance, your divine protection. And most of all, we ask your fellowship of the Holy Spirit, because you are the God of all comfort. Yes. And that, Holy Father, as we would lay the mortal remains of our brother there, may you be with us in everything, that our lives will continue to be a witness as his life was a witness to the truth of your gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The hymn, We Shall See the King.
Okay, there is a request, and gentlemen, you can. There is a request for one brief final viewing of the mortal remains, and we will facilitate it. And as soon as that is complete, we will take our leave.
Yes, go.
There's a blessed time that's coming, coming soon. It may be evening, morning, or at noon. The wedding of the bride, united with the groom.
Thank you. Things in the past, things yet unseen, wishes and dreams that are yet to come true. All of my hopes, all of my plans, my heart and my hands are lifted to you.
Lord.
I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Power of your love. live in me. Lord, bring you my mind as your will unfolds in my life and live in every day. By the power
Almighty God, we gather beside this grave today to lay the rest of the body of our friend Lionel DaCosta. We do so remembering another grave in another place, the tomb that received the body of our Lord Jesus. As Jesus came from the grave to live again, we know that all who die in him shall never truly die. Help us, Father, to walk by faith and not by sight, with our trust in him who said, "Do not be afraid, I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of death and hell. For as much as it has pleased Almighty God in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of our brother, we therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the resurrection at the last day and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, as whose coming to judge the world, the earth, and the sea shall give up their dead. The bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed and be made like the glorious body, according to that power by which he is able to subdue all things unto himself." The hymn, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine, oh what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood."
All the day long, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
thou art.
Thank you.
in the glory land, in the good old way. No?
Soon the pearly gates will open. shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all
sing the wondrous love of Jesus,
sing his mercy
and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all
the song Just a Rose will do.
You are tolling on this one?
Yeah.
Sorry with that. Heavenly Father, we want to give you thanks and praise for the life and witness of our Elder Alleyne. We want to thank and praise you for being with us even this morning. And because you are the God of all comfort, we commit, Lord God, the family into your hand. And you, as they continue, Lord God, to grieve, and as they continue, Lord God, to experience the absence from this body, we ask, Holy Father, that you would watch between them. Holy Father, and as we prepare to leave this place, we ask, O God, that you will grant us journey and mercies. And now to him who, by the power at work within us, is able to do far abundantly above that all that we ask or seek, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thank you.
Say the things that you would love to hear. It's in the very same heart that loved you from the start. It's in the heat. It's in the spirit. And it's got me totally high. It's just hard for me to say why. Far apart, didn't know how to say all the little things to make you stay, and not to keep assuming you could read my mind. You're the one. It's in the very same heart that loved you from the start. It's in the heat. It's in the spirit. And it's got me totally high. It's just hard for me to say why.